husband and wife who were always together, even in their last dance. Valentino Alvaro, 68 years old, servant of God, life of the party, storyteller, who made the whole room laugh, a man devoted to his children and his grandchildren. Maymay Manon, 65, bedrock of her family and friends. The eternal optimist, avid dancer, who'd visit the studio every weekend, often leaving snacks behind for her classmates. She radiated positive energy through her laughter, her kind words, and her smile. Moy Dayun, 67, refugee, community builder, cherished friend, known for her kindness, her sweetness, her generosity, her beloved family, the center of her world. Diana Tom, 7 years old, devoted daughter, wife, mother, grandmother, who loved to sing karaoke. A giver and an adventurer who loved to explore new foods and travel the world. Charles Zhao, 76, grateful, reflective, believed in living to the life to the fullest. He constantly showed his family and friends and showered them with warm words of encouragement, hope, and love. Tao Yo, 64, a lifelong learner. He retired as a business manager and was pursuing a second career as a pharmacist while caring for his elderly mother. A man beloved by his wife, children, and friends for his compassion, his determination, and his wisdom. Lily Lee, 63, a matriarch with absolute strength, optimism, and grace. Her daughter wrote, "Stolen is a grandmother whose granddaughter fell asleep many nights, nestled between her loving arms. Taken away is the opportunity for her grandson to feel her love and warmth." All of them live lives of love, sacrifice, and service for their families, for their community. They represent a bigger story, who we are as Americans, embodying the simple truth that our diversity is the strength of this nation. We saw that strength in Maria Leong, owner of Star Ballroom, who I want to thank for pouring her heart into creating a warm, welcome space to bring the community together, especially seniors. And we saw that strength in Brandon Say, who met me at the airport, whom Jill and I have gotten to know. 20 minutes after the rampage at Star Ballroom, Brandon saw the same shooter walk into his family's own dance studio, just 2 miles away, pointing a gun at him. In an instant, he found the courage to act and wrestle a semi-automatic firearm away. Brandon saved lives. He protected the community. At Half Moon Bay, just 2 days later, he got it. Brandon, stand up. Half Moon Bay, just 2 days later, we saw heroism from police officers, firefighters, and other first responders who rushed into the danger to save lives. As many of you know, Jill and I invited Brandon as our guest at the State of the Union message because we wanted the country to know all of you, not just Brandon, all of you, the character of this community, the faith you have in this community, the pride we see it in you, across all of American life. Just this week, a film about resilience and power of the Asian American immigrant family made history at the Oscars. Echoing the heart of so many in this community, We also hear a message we've heard too often, including 2 years ago this week, after the spa shooting in the Atlanta area. Enough! Do something! We remember and mourn today, but I'm here with you today to act. Last year, after the mass shooting in Buffalo, New York, and Uvalde, Texas, I signed into law, after being both places, a bipartisan Safer Communities Act, the most significant gun safety law in almost 30 years. That was in addition to me signing more executive actions to reduce gun violence than any of my predecessors at this point in the presidencies. Today, I'm announcing another executive order that will accelerate and intensify this work to save more lives more quickly. First, this executive order helps keep firearms out of dangerous hands. As I continue to call on Congress to require background checks for all firearm sales. And in the meantime, my executive order directs my Attorney General to take every lawful action possible to move us as close as we can to universal background checks without new legislation. It's just common sense to check whether someone is a felon, a domestic abuser, before they buy a gun. The executive order also expands public awareness campaigns about the red flag orders, laws, which my son, before he died, Attorney General in Delaware, was a great proponent of and instituted. So more parents, teachers, police officers, health providers, and counselors know how to flag for a court that someone is exhibiting violent tendencies, threatening classmates, or experiencing suicidal thoughts that make them a danger to themselves and others, and temporarily remove that person's access to firearms. And it promotes, this executive order, safe storage for firearms. Something every responsible gun owner agrees with. Second thing it does, the executive order ramps up our efforts to hold the gun industry accountable. It's the only outfit you can't sue these days. It does that by calling out for an independent government study that analyzes and exposes how gun manufacturers aggressively market firearms to civilians, especially minors, including by using military imagery. And it directs the Attorney General to publicly release alcohol, tobacco, and firearms inspection reports of firearms dealers who are cited for violation of the law. That way, policymakers can strengthen laws to crack down on those illegal gun dealers, and the public can avoid purchasing from them. Third, the executive order improves federal coordination to support victims, survivors, and their families and communities affected by mass shootings. The same way FEMA responds to your natural disaster in California and all around the nation, and it will help folks recover and build after wildfires and superstorms and droughts. For example, we need to provide more mental health support and grief and trauma, and more financial assistance when a family loses the sole breadwinner or when a small business shuts down due to a lengthy shooting investigation. There's more in this executive order, but I'm not stopping there. Last week, I laid out in my budget that we invest more in safer communities and expand access to mental health services for those affected by gun violence. Congressional Republicans should pass my budget instead of calling for cuts in these services or defunding the police or abolishing the FBI, as we hear from our MAGA Republican friends. But let's be clear. None of this absolves Congress from the responsibility of acting to pass universal background checks, eliminate gun manufacturers' immunity from liability. And I'm determined, once again, to ban assault weapons and high-capacity magazines. I led that fight in, to ban them in 1994. The 10 years that law was in place, mass shootings went down. Our Republican friends let it expire when it, and 10 years later. And mass shootings tripled since then, tripled. So let's finish the job. Ban assault weapons. Ban them again. Do it now. Enough. Do something. Do something big. Folks, let me close with this. Scripture says, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. A lot of us have been there. If you gather here today, I know your hearts are broken, but I know your spirits are strong. And as you remember and heal, I know the light of your loved one is once again going to lead you forward. It takes time. I tell everyone, at least it did with me, it takes time. But I promise you, the day will come when the memory of your loved one brings a smile to your lips before it brings a tear to your eye. Tear will never fully go away. But when you had that smile first remembrance, that's when you know. That's when you know you're going to make it. You're going to know you're going to make it. My prayer for all of you, that day will come sooner than later, but I promise you, it will come. God bless you all. I admire you so damn much. Thank you.